Item number, SCP-285. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-285 is to be kept in a level 3 humanoid containment chamber on Site-43's B-Wing. SCP-285 is to be given basic amenities. Following SCP-285's recent cooperation with the Foundation, it is allowed exactly 2 hours of free-roaming Site-43's botanical gardens, with supervision by at least one guard if it so chooses. Personnel are not to discuss SCP-285's past with POI-6938 without approval of Site-43's director. If this occurs, authorized technical staff are to manually remove the information from SCP-285-B via use of SCP-285-A. SCP-285-B instances are not to be edited without the permission of the administrator of Site-43's technical staff. SCP-285 is to never be given its full abilities back under any circumstances. Description: SCP-285 is an anomalous humanoid entity with no defined shape or internal structure, the exception being SCP-285-A, which consistently manifests itself on the object's back. SCP-285's body changes sporadically, with no pattern among the alterations. Despite the trauma SCP-285 incurs as a result of this bodily mutation, it will not at any point display signs of homeostatic distress. Subject claims it cannot control these changes. These changes include, but are not limited to, loss and growth of new limbs, variable size and shape of body parts, loss and growth of height and mass. SCP-285-A appears to be an Ethernet port, which allows access to SCP-285's internal database. When accessed by a computer capable of wired connections between networks, various files are capable of being accessed. These files, SCP-285-B, contain various text files, audio files, cognitohazards, and videos. 90% of all files have been corrupted. The cause of this corruption is currently unknown. Additionally, SCP-285 is only capable of accessing files that were formed within its own database. Investigations into SCP-285-B and its contents reveal that editing of SCP-285-B could cause external changes on SCP-285's body and psychological state. To what extent this is possible without causing permanent damage to SCP-285 is currently unknown. It is believed that POI-6938 used this ability to evade GOI-102, Unusual Incidents Unit, through consistent use of editing SCP-285's facial structure and body type, along with editing in thaumatological-based offense capabilities to defend against GOI-102 agents. Recovery: SCP-285 was recovered following an attempted arrest involving itself and an unknown individual, currently believed to be SCP-285's creator, in Las Vegas, Nevada. SCP-285 and the unknown individual, POI-6938, were initially pulled over for speeding, before the officer discovered that POI-6938 had attacked a federal building in California. This federal building was later revealed to have been under the direct control of GOI-102, and was used as a prison for anomalous humanoids. The attack by POI-6938 and SCP-285 ended in the deaths of 34 GOI-102 personnel and the release of roughly 70% of the prison population. The officer attempted to arrest SCP-285 and POI-6938, but was attacked by SCP-285. POI-6938 then escaped, leaving SCP-285 with the officer. SCP-285 was then arrested and put into GOI-102 custody before eventually being given over to the Foundation, following an anomalous trade of information between GOI-102 and the Foundation. Both local law enforcement and federal agents were unable to locate POI-6938. Anomalous pathways located in Nevada are currently being investigated with Joint Foundation-UIU task forces. Interview log. Interviewer: Dr. Henderson. Subject: SCP-285. Begin log. Dr. Henderson, what is your purpose? SCP-285. I don't know. Dr. Henderson, how do you not know? SCP-285. I just don't know. I have an idea of why I was created, but I'm not too sure. Dr. Henderson, well, tell me why you think you were created. SCP-285. Well, to entertain kids. Originally, I think. Although, my purpose was probably altered, for lack of a better word. Dr. Henderson, how do you think you were altered? SCP-285. It's hard to explain. I remember some things perfectly, but others I can't even think of. I think he was mad, and he wanted to hurt someone. And he used me to help hurt them. I hope he didn't succeed. Dr. Henderson, why do you not want him to succeed? SCP-285, I don't want to hurt anyone. Dr. Henderson, then why did you attack that officer? SCP-285 pauses. SCP-285, I just did as I was told, but I think that's the only time he ever made me hurt someone. At least, I think he did. Dr. Henderson, why do you think your creator put these various files onto you? SCP-285. Insurance, I guess. Dr. Henderson, explain. SCP-285. You see, I remember my, database, for lack of a better word, being biological in nature. My brain, Tap's forehead, contains all the information in my database, even if I can't access anything he put on me, or anything he didn't want me to see. Dr. Henderson, so, if your brain were to be damaged or if you were to die, all the files within your database would disappear. SCP-285. Not disappear as much as just become corrupted. But yes, that's the idea. He wanted to make sure that if I was to get captured by the UIU or whatever it was called, that they wouldn't have been able to read my files. He really hated those guys. Maybe that's what made him mad in the first place. I remember whenever I brought it up, he'd get angry and yell at me a lot. I cried a little, but not a lot. He hates when I cry. It's not my fault that he created me to cry. Dr. Henderson, did he bring anything up that would maybe have explained why he was so angry? SCP-285. No, but the way he sounded, it was like the end of the world to him. That's why he created me, I think. Why he altered me. He wanted to use me as something. As a weapon, I guess? Whatever it was. He wanted to hurt the UIU. He used to go on and on about how they were evil and deserved to be destroyed because they took everything from him and how they all need to die. It was scary. Dr. Henderson, well, the UIU is not evil. I can say that with confidence. SCP-285. How, though? He told me they kidnap and murder innocent people who've done nothing but exist. Told me how they made being alive hell for him and his friends and family. I've never had a family, but that must hurt, right? Dr. Henderson, whatever your creator told you, it was inaccurate to reality. SCP-285. If you say so, Doctor. I trust you more than him, anyways. Dr. Henderson, why do you think your creator left you behind? SCP-285. He was done with me. Dr. Henderson, how was he done with you? SCP-285. He had done what he wanted to do, whatever it was. I guess I was just one more loose end. Dr. Henderson, if you truly were a loose end, as you described, why did he not kill you himself? SCP-285. I think he was. And after uploading all the files into my database, he was gonna do that. But he got interrupted. And he panicked. And he had just hoped that the cop would just finish me off. Glad he didn't do that, you know? I like living. Better than whatever I was before. Dr. Henderson, why do you think you wanted to get rid of all the files in your database? SCP-285. Something was there. Something about some other people. He did something to them. Stole something real important to them. I think he was a part of them at one point, but left. Maybe I was a part of them too, I don't know. But I know that whatever group it was, he didn't want them coming after him, or finding me. Dr. Henderson, do you remember the name of this group? SCP-285. I don't know, man. I remember him talking about some f***ing stoners, but that's pretty much it. End log. Addendum 285.1. The following collection of documents are filed in chronological order, based off of documents from SCP-285's internal database and GOI-102-related documents. The purpose of this collection is to provide a possible time frame regarding SCP-285's creation and POI-6938's overall motive and goal. Document A. The following document was a deleted audio file, believed to be addressed to SCP-285's original owners. Data corrupted. I don't give a damn what Blunt thinks or says. I need him. Without him, I wouldn't have gotten this far. The damn feds are crawling all over the damn place, and this guy is the only thing keeping them away from me. If anything, you should be glad he's around. Better for them to be mind to oblivion than just killed, right? Man, you really gave this guy some sweet powers. You sure this guy was meant to be a kitty thing? I thought we were meant to be pacifists or something. Not that I'm complaining. You know, that's the one thing I've always hated about you two. You're too damn soft. You don't ever fight back. You just sit on your ass and make jokes and do nothing. Yeah, it was fun what we did. For a while, at any rate. Then Jordan got taken. You two wouldn't understand what it's like to have to take care of someone, look after someone, do some real shitty things to protect the ones that you love. Data corrupted. And every damn time I tried asking you and the others about what we should do about Jordan, about how the Ravens took him. Remember what you f***ing said, Jude? He got what he deserved? Well, I remember that. Data corrupted. Maybe we need a couple of terrorists in the world to knock the man a peg or two down. Data corrupted. Document B. Document currently believed to be in reference to Jordan from Document A. UIU file 2016-982. Codename Merrymaker. Summary. Suspect capable of performing high-class thaumatology and minor reality warping. Possible connections to the Serpent's Hand, an anomalous terrorist organization, and is primarily active in Southern California and Nevada. Possible member of the secretive location known as the Library, the main base of the Serpent's Hand. Name, unknown, but has consistently given out the first name Jordan. Irregularity cross-reference. Human, magician, terrorist, American, Serpent's Hand. Physical description. Note, subject to consistent changes. Sex, male. Height, 72 inches. Weight and build, 189 pounds, large. Race, white. Hair, brown. Eyes, blue. Identifying attributes. Tattoos depicting a hand strangling an American eagle, hammer smashing a five-pointed star, and several hands tugging at a logo with three arrows pointing inwards. Capabilities. Suspect is capable of performing offensive thaumatic spells. These spells include fire-based projectiles, sentient flesh-based creations formed from his own epidermis, and capable of forming ways. These ways are not permanent and are incredibly unstable. In all cases, ways produced by the suspect are incapable of transporting him at long distances. These ways also cause temporary physical and mental effects to the suspect. Suspect suffers from vomiting and nausea after forming ways. Purpose and motive. Primarily motivated by hatred of organizations or agencies responsible for preserving and maintaining consensus reality, along with curbing activity in the anomalous community. Believes that the only way anomalous humans can continue to exist is by the destruction of any and all normalcy agencies. Willing to cooperate with any group or person as long as this primary motive is maintained. Modus operandi. Suspect often works with terrorist organizations, specifically the Serpent's Hand, various anarchist sects, and, on one occasion, with a currently unidentified anomalous terrorist group. Its cooperation is often in tandem with the organization's opposition to normalcy agencies. Behavior: behaves with very little remorse or empathy towards non-anomalous entities. Exhibits unwillingness to socialize with other people, both anomalous and non-anomalous. Document C. The following document was recovered inside of SCP-285's memory files. Originally a video, but only the audio was recovered. Audio begins with the sound of a car driving down a road. A male voice can be heard talking, identified as POI-6938. POI-6938. They're f***ing animals. All of them. They beat us, abuse us, make us follow their rules, which always f***ing put us at a disadvantage, and they expect us not to fight back. It's horrible. SCP-285 does not speak. POI-6938. Well, me and you will show them. We're gonna get Jordan back, and then him and me and you are gonna take this world. Right, Hacks? SCP-285 does not respond. POI-6938. Right, Hacks? SCP-285. Yes, sir. POI-6938. That's more like it. Now get ready. Some feds are up ahead. This place should be where they keep the prisoner lists and shit. And hand me that mask. Just because you don't need one doesn't mean I don't. The car slows down to a halt, with the two car doors opening and slamming closed. Faint talking can be heard, along with the sound of a door opening and closing. Audio cuts out for 31 minutes before beginning once again. Vomiting noises can be heard as someone is yelling. POI-6938. God f***ing damn it. You f***ed ass. Can't you do anything right? SCP-285. I'm sorry. Alright, I just can't. SCP-285 is cut off by vomiting. POI-6938. Damn it, Blunt. Why did he have to make you so much of a pansy? SCP-285. Oh god, I can't do this. It hurts. POI-6938. I'd expect so. They made me put that feature in. SCP-285. They? POI-6938. Yeah, the f***ing stoners. Blame them for what's going on. When someone like me or some other person feels bad for killing someone, it's like 5 times as painful for you. Increased empathy and the like. I would have made you like me, but they just had to be... Vomiting noises begins again. SCP-285. Get it out of me! Help me! Make me a sociopath or something! I can't. I won't do this for the rest of my life. POI-6938. I can't. It's a built-in thing they made me put in you. I'd have to kill you to remove it. So better get used to it, Hacks. Thankfully, it wasn't too useless. We got what we needed. Go and, get some rest or whatever. SCP-285. Yes, sir. End video. Document D. The following phone call is believed to be between POI-6938 and POI-6939, Jordan, after they had escaped the correctional facility where Jordan had originally been placed. POI-6938. Hey, dude, you there? Jordan. Yes, I am. What happened? POI-6938. F*** if I know, man. Our, mutual friends did something to Hacks. Jordan. What do you mean, did something to it? POI-6938. I can't mess with his files now. Without possibly killing him at any rate. Jordan. And? POI-6938. Which means he's a liability. They know his face. And he doesn't have any of the fancy stuff he used to have. Now he just sorta changes at random. He's too dangerous. Jordan, what do we do? POI-6938. We, do what we need to. Jordan, of course. Where will it be? POI-6938. Outside of Vegas. I'll meet you at Salt Lake. Jordan, all right. Just be careful, all right? POI-6938. You know I am, brother. Love you. Jordan. Love you too. Addendum 285.2. The following document was discovered inside of a sealed envelope addressed to Site 43 staff. Dear janitors slash ravens, I know this type of thing isn't our usual style, but we as a group decided that this situation couldn't be considered normal by any stretch of the imagination. We know you have hacks, and we know what happened to him, including what happened with Ken and Jordan, and what they planned on doing to him. How we know this is not important, but what is important is what we learned from it, and we just want to say one thing to everyone involved. We're sorry. We're sorry we trusted a monster who we thought was our friend. We're sorry that we couldn't stop him in time. We're sorry that we couldn't prevent what you went through, Hex. I, and the rest of the group, want to say that we never wanted this to end this way. For Hex, for you janitors, or for the Ravens, who didn't deserve what happened to them. We just wanted to bring happiness to children with your powers. We just wanted to mock you and the Ravens. We didn't mean for this. We never intended for things to end like this. We're so, so sorry. Signed, Gamers Against Weed. P.S. Don't worry about Ken or Jordan. We've dealt with them. Item number, SCP-280. Object Class, Keter. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-280 is to be contained in a 5x5 meter cell, and no equipment of any kind is to be left inside when staff are not present. Containment area is to be kept in total darkness at all times. Any items taken into the containment cell must be removed by staff at the end of testing, and any staff entering into containment must wear infrared goggles and be equipped with an infrared ID strobe and a strong flashlight. In the event of an SCP-280 attack, all staff are to power on their flashlights and illuminate the subject under attack. No aggressive action is to be taken against SCP-280, and staff are to keep 1 meter from SCP-280 at all times. Staff should continue to illuminate SCP-280 until it retreats to a sufficient distance to allow the recovery and extraction of the subject of the attack. Description: SCP-280 is a black human-shaped mass with two large white eyes on the head and two hands with very long and thin fingers. No feet or legs are visible, as the lower portion of the body appears to fade away several centimeters from the ground. SCP-280 appears to be wholly composed of a matter that can gain or lose corporeal form. This matter is very black, with only the eyes showing any other color, and when changing to a non-corporeal form, looks much like smoke. The eyes are non-functioning, and appear only when SCP-280 is retreating, appearing to be used like eye spots on some insects. SCP-280 is very strong, and has been observed pulling apart steel with its hands, showing no sign of stress. SCP-280 moves with a gliding motion, with its hands extended, described as a sleepwalker pose by observers. SCP-280 will move slowly towards any human beings and attempt to attack them. SCP-280 appears to sense human life. No limit has yet been found on this ability. SCP-280 will approach to within 14 centimeters of a subject, and then use its hands to pull and tear at the subject, causing massive physical trauma. The attack can last between 1 and 5 minutes, and will continue until the death of the subject, at which point SCP-280 will expose its eyes, lose corporeal form, and move to the next human. If no humans are present, SCP-280 will move and ball up against a wall or other structure until a human being is again present. SCP-280 will retreat slowly from light, exposing its eyes in the direction of the light or at any nearby humans. This has been described as extremely disconcerting by those who have been stared at. If the area that SCP-280 currently resides in becomes fully illuminated, or there is a very bright burst of light, SCP-280 will fade away and reappear in another area. This appears to be done purely as a defensive response to light, and will not be used to follow or attack prey. SCP-280 does not appear to eat, breathe, or sleep. It does not ingest any of the tissue removed during an attack, and simply drops it to tear a new piece. Due to its ability to become incorporeal at will, and its aggressive nature, No samples of SCP-280 have been collected. Addendum. Notes on recovery. SCP-280 was recovered in Mississippi after several reports of locked room murders and child deaths. All were reported as being extremely vicious, and victims were, quote, horribly mangled. The Foundation became involved after a family of five was murdered in their home. A survivor was found in the basement, 9-year-old David, who had come over for a sleepover. He was found in an advanced state of shock, holding a flashlight and unresponsive to outside stimulus. During an investigation of the basement, an officer was attacked and badly mutilated. His statement attracted the interest of Foundation agents. During recovery, SCP-280 was temporarily lost due to its ability to teleport when exposed to high levels of light. It was also observed that SCP-280 is frequently discounted as a shadow when seen in the dark, or dismissed as clothing, hair, or another object when accidentally touched in the dark. When tracking a subject, SCP-280 will remain incorporeal until the moment of attack, causing some to walk very close to or through SCP-280. Subjects report a feeling of dread and unease when inside SCP-280. SCP-280 usually does not respond to this, but will sometimes expose its eyes and enter its retreating posture when passed through. No pattern has emerged for this behavior. Addendum. Notes following testing. During a series of extensive testing of the effects of various illumination sources on SCP-280's retreat reflex, SCP-280 broke containment. SCP-280 was observed to repeatedly appear and dissipate throughout the illuminated site, progressing through the sublevels, and eventually appearing in SCP-1591's containment chamber. Upon being exposed to SCP-1591, SCP-280 displayed its eyes, but did not retreat. The entity paused and knelt for several minutes before demanifestation. SCP-280 reappeared in its cell several hours later without incident. Item Number SCP-303. Object Class Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. As SCP-303 has not yet been known to travel beyond the boundaries of Site, the entire area of said location is currently considered SCP-303's containment area. All rooms in Site are to be altered where possible so as to have two entrances separated by a distance of 10 meters or line of sight. Personnel are to be distributed evenly throughout the facility with available radio or intercom contact so that encounters may be resolved quickly. Personnel who witness SCP-303 are to be submitted for immediate psychiatric evaluation. All SCP objects housed at Site since before 6410 are to be transferred to Site B, one at a time. Each SCP object will be transferred again to Site A once it can be verified that SCP-303 has not migrated from Site with it. Once SCP-303 either migrates to Site B or remains present at Site once all SCPs in question have been transferred to Site A, containment procedures will be updated as appropriate. Description. Witnesses describe SCP-303 as a nude, sexless, emaciated humanoid figure with reddish-brown skin. Instead of normal facial features, its head is dominated by an extremely large mouth, which bears a set of oversized human teeth. It continually vocalizes a wheezing noise, loud enough to be heard from the other side of most solid doors. All individuals who have had encounters with SCP-303 are capable of describing it in full, including individuals who have not physically seen any part of it. SCP-303 will periodically materialize behind any closed door, hatch, or other entryway barrier opposite a sentient observer, chosen by unknown means. SCP-303 will then remain behind the door for an indeterminate amount of time. Any individual attempting to open the door or barrier experiences intense, paralyzing fear that lasts until SCP-303 dematerializes, either on its own or to avoid being directly seen by another observer. The source of this fear is not clear, but appears to be similar in nature to arachnophobia and ophidiophobia, originating on a preconscious genetic level. Data expunged. Analysis indicates that SCP-303 is not, in fact, purposefully inducing fear in the affected individuals. SCP-303 does not allow itself to come into direct visual contact with any observer, and has never allowed any one individual to view more than 10% of its form. When the door or other entryway barrier is partially or completely transparent, SCP-303 will materialize in an orientation that leaves 10% or less of its body visible, or cause effects of fog or frost on the transparent surface to achieve the same effect. If SCP-303 is approached from a direction in which there is not a solid object or door breaking line of sight, it will dematerialize before direct visual contact is made. Any electronic or complex mechanical devices that SCP-303 encounters are temporarily disabled. SCP-303 has made no recorded attempt to physically or verbally engage any observer. How SCP-303 arrived at site is not known at this time. SCP-303's first recorded appearance was on 3-1-10. It is suspected that SCP-303 was inadvertently transferred along with or manifested by another SCP on site. All SCPs at said location are being re-examined accordingly. Incident Log 303A. Incident 3031. Agent R was showering in her private quarters bathroom when she became aware of the presence of SCP-303 on the opposite side of the shower curtain. It was wheezing extremely loudly. Startled by the discovery, she accidentally struck the shower curtain, causing it to sway outwards. The curtain partially wrapped around SCP-303, revealing that it was less than 0.5 meters from the curtain, standing erect and facing the shower. Agent R reports spending approximately the next 3 hours sobbing in the shower, quietly, as not to disturb SCP-303. Agent R reported that the wheezing stopped very suddenly, at which point in time she was able to exit the shower. Incident 3033. Agent B encountered SCP-303 inside the site second floor break room. He was attempting to obtain coffee creamer from the counter cabinet when he heard loud wheezing emanating from the cabinet and was overtaken by overwhelming fear. Agent B later reported that SCP-303 was huddled in the cabinet in the fetal position. Agent B claimed to be certain of the information, despite failing to open the cabinet door. Later, when the cabinet was examined, one container of powdered coffee creamer was missing. Note: this is the first recorded instance of SCP-303 removing an object from a scene. Incident 3036. Dr. was discovered dead from dehydration in a second floor storage room. It is estimated that said doctor spent up to 5 days in the storage room before being discovered. A small 4 meter by 4 meter decompression chamber separated the storage room from the adjoining hallway. SCP-303 occupied the decompression chamber for the duration of Dr. B's isolation in the storage room, disallowing entry from either direction and making it impossible for the doctor to leave. Test Log 303A. A team consisting of Dr. G, Researcher M, 4 security personnel, and 4 D-class personnel were assigned to be dispatched to any reported incident of SCP-303's materialization in order to immediately perform on-site testing. These logs take place at the door to room from the first floor hallway. SCP-303 was reported to be within room test 3031. 1 male D-class personnel, D-3031, was ordered to open the door and threatened that he would be transferred to SCP duty for non-compliance. He refused, citing extreme fear. Test 3032. 1 male D-class personnel, D-3031, was ordered to open the door and threatened that he would be terminated on the spot for non-compliance. he refused, claiming that if he were to do so, that SCP-303 would data expunged. He was terminated on the spot. Test 3033. One female D-Class personnel, D-3032, that had witnessed the termination of D-3031, was ordered to open the door, and threatened that she would be terminated on the spot for non-compliance. She refused, claiming that if she opened the door, that SCP-303 would data expunged. Researcher T was visibly shaken by this claim. D-3032 was not terminated. Test 3034. One female D-Class personnel, D-3032, was ordered to open the door. One male D-Class personnel, D-3033, was given one combat knife by security personnel and ordered to data expunged until D-3032 opened the door. After 2 hours of data expunged, D-3032 died from blood loss. D-3032 made no attempt to open the door. Addendum 5110. SCP-303 appears to have claimed the second floor storage room as its own. It has so far disallowed any personnel entry to the room since 4510. It leaves periodically to acquire Foundation property, which is then moved into the second floor storage room. To date, the following list describes all non-classified items taken by SCP-303. 1 cryo tube. 3 sets of standard Foundation surgical equipment. Data expunged. 2 D-Class research cadavers. 1 gasoline-powered generator. A variety of chemicals, including large quantities of tryptophan, phenylalanine, and tyrosine, among others. And 1 container of powdered coffee creamer. In addition to this, a number of classified materials have been obtained by SCP-303. Staff are still attempting to determine what specific purposes SCP-303 may have for these materials. Item number SCP-305. Object Class Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-305 is presently immobile. Site-305 has been constructed around its present location, a wooded canyon near, and is staffed by at least 7 personnel who have prior experience with SCP-305 and proved resistant to its effects. The remainder of the station crew should be rotated on a weekly basis. SCP-305's effect grows weaker if human subjects are exposed to it for extended periods of time. Therefore, a resistant subject should be exposed to it for at least 3 hours daily. SCP-305's effects are greatly magnified in individuals with feelings of guilt, particularly over crimes or mental instability. Therefore, Site-305 is staffed exclusively by non-D-Class researchers and agents who are screened for criminal records and mental instability. Any personnel who begin to hear whispered compliments must be transferred out immediately. If symptoms persist after removal, frontal lobotomy, data expunged. The actual containment chamber of SCP-305 is constructed of standard materials and offset from the rest of the station by a 5-meter buffer zone to protect normal staff from the worst of SCP-305's effects. Site-305 broadcasts a constant status normal signal to Site-19. If Site-305 becomes compromised during a containment breach, this signal will cease, and a heavily armed containment team will immediately be dispatched to the location. Instances of SCP-305-1 are extremely dangerous and should be terminated on site without attempting containment. As of 2000, all attempts to extract samples from SCP-305 for study are forbidden. Description. SCP-305 is a rock formation of approximately humanoid size and shape. Remote recordings of SCP-305 show that it remains stationary at all times, even when interacting with human subjects. When viewed by a sentient observer, SCP-305 appears to be a mobile, animate humanoid of indeterminate sex. This manifestation is formed of cracked rock, similar to SCP-305's physical form. And while it is faceless, subjects report that the cracks all over SCP-305's surface begin to resemble human lips and ears as it moves. Human subjects who make visual contact with this manifestation hear whispering voices, although recording equipment in the area picks up nothing, and the phenomenon is observed even in subjects who are deaf from birth. SCP-305 will initially ingratiate itself with the subject by whispering compliments. During this phase, the subject experiences feelings of friendliness and trust towards SCP-305. These sensations seem unrelated to the actual content of the compliments, which ranges from off to nonsensical and disturbing. A short list of reported compliments is included. You have beautiful eye sockets. Every one of your fingers. Your neck appears unusually flexible. In the second phase, the subject begins to hear many voices emanating from SCP-305. At this point, the whispers become critical, attempting to insult the subject or undermine the subject's self-esteem, especially by playing on the subject's guilty conscience. Like the compliments, these insults make little sense when recounted, but have a profound psychological effect, driving the subject to suicide before the final phase in 20% of cases. If the subject is removed from SCP-305's presence during Phase 2, the subject will hallucinate that these insults are emanating from mouth-like cracks that appear to form on the ground, walls, and ceiling. In the third and final phase, the voices will abruptly stop. 2 to 10 hours from the cessation of hallucinations, SCP-305's humanoid manifestation will appear and kill the subject. Causes of death are varied, but include severe cardiac infarct, muscle spasm leading to severing of the spinal column, diaphragm paralysis, and a subject who dies of any cause after the beginning of the second phase, data expunged, followed by the emergence of an instance of SCP-305-1 from the corpse. SCP-305-1 are humanoids, slightly smaller than SCP-305 itself. Unlike SCP-305, SCP-305-1 seem to be made of a smooth, hard white substance, and the lips and mouths on their surfaces are extremely lifelike. SCP-305-1 have the same abilities as SCP-305, and although they are created with a very short range of 2 meters, this range increases exponentially over time. SCP-305-1 move at 30 kilometers an hour, and seem naturally drawn in a direct line towards the nearest densely populated area, presumably in an attempt to further propagate themselves. SCP-305-1 are highly resistant to bullets and cutting weapons. Elimination teams should be equipped with heavy ballistics and explosives. In subjects who have entered Stage 2, manifestation of SCP-305-1 can only be prevented by removal of 80% data expunged. Addendum 3051. On 2000, Foundation personnel used a remote-controlled device to extract a sample of SCP-305's rock structure. SCP-305 began to emit loud grinding noises and a low growling sound. Existing cracks in the rock formation deepened, and several new ones formed in the vicinity of the removed rock sample. SCP-305 then moved its arms upward slightly and slid 1 foot, about 10 centimeters, across the ground as if taking a step, shedding rock fragments as it moved before returning to its stationary state. Following this event, the range of SCP-305's psychic influence tripled, resulting in several data expunged. Sample proved to be ordinary sedimentary rock, consistent with the surrounding area. Follow-up X-ray scans of the formation itself reveal the presence of suggesting that the rock formation may actually be an imprisoned instance of data expunged. Upgrade to Keter requested. Pending. Item number SCP-213. Object Class. Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-213 is contained in a high-security humanoid containment cell within Site 77. The chamber is to be surrounded by a 10-meter-wide zone filled with gaseous materials corrosive to human skin. SCP-213 should be informed as to the nature of its containment, to prevent manifestation of its effect, which would result in additional containment breaches. A staffing of 2 guards armed with high-pressure hoses, oleoresin capsicum, and polymer web grenades should be stationed outside the containment unit at all times. Description: SCP-213 is an adolescent humanoid male, 1.5 meters tall, weighing 95 kilograms. SCP-213 is able to forcefully sever the bonds between atoms and any solid or semi-solid matter with physical contact. An intense flash of light is produced when doing so. SCP-213 can use any part of its body to manifest this effect, and has used it to disintegrate projectiles as they impact its body. Manifestation of this effect has proven to be extremely painful, with extended use causing enough pain to render SCP-213 unconscious. SCP-213 was recovered from Palo Alto, California, when reports of a teenage boy being arrested for homicide after vaporizing his girlfriend during coitus reached agents embedded in the local police department. Further investigation revealed SCP-213's anomalous properties. However, during initial containment, SCP-213 vaporized the agents attempting to apprehend it. During the ensuing firefight with an MTF agent, SCP-213 was able to disable 2 agents before being contained. SCP-213's containment procedures were finalized in 19 and classified as Euclid. Addendum 213-07. SCP-213 has made its 7th escape attempt. After asking for another interview with Dr. SCP-213 waited for security personnel to allow her to enter the containment chamber. As the majority of the containment procedures were disengaged, SCP-213 was able to apply its effect to the remaining security measures and breach containment. SCP-213 killed Doctor, as well as 2 agents during the initial stage of its breach. SCP-213 had only seen a small portion of the facility and was easily apprehended after it encountered heavy resistance from security. Breaking through its cell weakened it enough to prevent further damage to other containment units. SCP-213 was apprehended in the site break room, attempting to break through the floor. However, extensive use of its effect left it unable to do so. Addendum 213-08. SCP-213 unintentionally breached containment in 2000. Due to the nature of this breach, no consequence has been issued. Video feed taken at 3:15 a.m. from SCP-213's cell show its bed and a section of the floor being affected, which caused SCP-213 to fall into a basement level. Containment procedures have been slated for revision. Researchers note: from the study of this video, it is clear that SCP-213's control of the effect is not as perfect as it previously believed, and it has become more cooperative with us in trying to establish a method to control and utilize it. Vague conjecture on the part of the review staff as to possibilities of what would occur should the effect trigger accidentally, including SCP-213 self-vaporizing, are noted as being particularly useful in this regard. Addendum 213-09. 1. During a routine physical examination of SCP-213, lesions were discovered on its back, appearing as smooth nodules. Presently, there are 4 nodules, placed at intervals on the subject's back in a perfect square. Distance between all 4 points is exactly 15 centimeters. Medical personnel have been assigned to SCP-213's containment in order to observe and rapidly respond to changes in this condition. Follow-up examinations have been scheduled. 2. A follow-up examination has led to the discovery of 2 more nodules, located in the center of its palms. SCP-213 reports mild irritation, but no pain or discomfort. They resist pressure applied with blunt or sharp instruments. During an attempt to excise a sample using a scalpel, the scalpel failed to cut and vaporized after a few seconds of applied pressure. SCP-213 denies responsibility for this occurrence. SCP-213 has become notably more apathetic, and has expressed feelings of extreme pain from its back and stomach. 3. SCP-213 was moved to intensive care after being observed having a seizure in its containment cell. Examination of SCP-213 shows an additional 10 nodules have appeared on its back. A perfect distance of 5 centimeters separates each one. SCP-213 continues to report no pain from the lesions. SCP-213 has been assigned additional medical observers, who will remain outside its containment with the standard guard staff for the next week. 4. All nodules on SCP-213 have disappeared and been replaced with thin incisions, slightly less than 1 millimeter in width. During inspection of these new changes, the medical examiner witnessed the incision on SCP-213's left palm open, and an eye was observed watching her. SCP-213 has been placed in the medical wing indefinitely, pending further changes to the subject's condition. Addendum 213-10. The source of SCP-213's effect appears to be a parasitic infestation of unknown origin, inhabiting its body. This life form has not attempted to communicate, but does observe any persons in SCP-213's presence through the lesions present on SCP-213's body. SCP-213 has exhibited panic over this development and requested several times the entity be removed from him. Any requests of this nature from SCP-213 are to be denied, pending further research. Researcher note: the organism inhabiting SCP-213 fails to show up on any medical scan we have at our disposal. The new hypothesis is that this effect actually serves to provide sustenance and self-defense, with repeated tests to determine the nature of the anomaly has led to increased growth. SCP-213 has been placed in a chemically induced coma until further research can be conducted regarding the nature of this parasite. Containment procedures slated for major revision.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.